The enigma of the lost tribes of Israel has puzzled Bible scholars for centuries. Millions of Israelites just disappeared and vanished into history forever, never to be seen again. Whilst around the same time period, millions of people just magically appeared, becoming what we call the Germanic tribes. I'm sure it's all just a coincidence. Welcome to the first part of a new series where we will uncover where each tribe of Israel is located today, where we will examine the evidence, explore the clues, and uncover lost history and piece together what we can find out, starting with the tribe of Dan. In the early Greek classical literature, Theodorus Siculus mentions a Moses leading his people, the Israelites, out of Egypt during the Exodus, into a region called Judea. This shows that there are in fact records of the 12 tribes even in the Greek classics. But also mentioned is that a vast number, instead of following Moses, rallied together and sailed for Greece. So many of the Greeks were in fact Israelites, even though they didn't realize it. They were led by Zara's descendants, Darda and Calchus, the kingly lion from Judah. Now this was the beginning of the prophecy that all Adamic nations would gradually be replaced by Israelites, the promises Yahweh God made. Darda is known for settling the region that he named Dardania, and later his descendants set up Troy, whilst Calchus is known for setting up the city Thebes and introducing the Hebrew Phoenician alphabet. But there is also another group that came with them called the Danaans or Danoi. They settled in Archaea, the northern part of the Peloponnesus Peninsula of Greece, so they were also called Archaeans. They were said to be descended from a Danaus the Egyptian. He was a legendary leader, and according to the legend, he was a son of Abelus, king of Egypt. The truth no doubt got confounded a bit, and these were certainly the Israelite tribe of Dan, who was the son of Bela. The island Sardinia was even named after them, Shar Dania, meaning remnant of Dan. It still bears that name today. How interesting that a place would bear the name of Dan. Jacob prophesied concerning Dan that wherever his descendants were to go, they would leave a serpent's path. The snake, as it slithers along the ground, it leaves a trail or a track. In the same manner, Dan's descendants would do this by leaving signs and waymarks throughout their travels and the migration routes they followed. In other words, they would name the places they traveled and settled to after their patriarch Dan. We even see this demonstrated in the Old Testament. Dan originally lived in a territory next to Ephraim, Benjamin, and Judah, and also the Philistines. During the Judges period, 600 Danaanites sought a new territory in the north of Canaan, and on their way they camped in a place in Judah which the Danaanites called Manahan Dan, meaning Camp of Dan. After they had smitten the people of Laish with the sword and burned the city, they called the new city Dan. The children of Dan continued this practice throughout their migrations, and we can find a trail of names all throughout Europe. In Hebrew, there are no vowels, so the name Dan is written D-N, or its Hebrew equivalent. So words like Dan, Din, Don, Dun, Den, or D-N correspond to the name of Dan. Just take a look at the names of the rivers of Europe. We have the Danube, the Danyepa, the Danyester, the Danau, the Daisy, the Davy, the Dan, the Don, the Udon, the Eridon, and thousands of others, Dans and Dons of ancient and early geography. However, it is not just limited to rivers, but also towns, cities, settlements, and as we will find out, even entire nations would bear the name of Dan. Greece wasn't the only place with a people called Dan. The early Irish history also tells us of a people called the Tuatha De Danaan, which literally means the people of Dan. They were said to be descended from a Dana, which is obviously Dan. They arrived in several waves of migrations, roughly between 1200 and 800 BC. Now this would be around the Judges period, and when we examine the text of the Book of the Judges, this fits perfectly. The Song of Deborah and Barak, during the ongoing battle, it asked, why did Dan remain in ships? And Dan abode in ships. Dan did not participate, so what were they up to? The territory of the tribe of Dan had a major seaport, Joppa, giving them easy access to ships, and some must have been seafarers. Evidently, some chose to migrate rather than get involved in the battles, and some must have reached the coast of Ireland. Upon their arrival, they conquered the Firbolgs, a race of people who were living in Ireland at the time, who likely were Japhethites. The Danites ruled Ireland from then on until the arrival of the Malaysians, who were another branch of the Israelites. They had several battles until peace was established, but from then on, Ireland was ruled by the Malaysian kings. This demonstrates how far and wide the Danites were travelling to. The Viper's Trail was not just the rivers, but many towns and settlements were also named after Dan. In Northern Ireland, we have Donegal, which means Fort of Dan, and in Scotland, we have the River Don. Throughout Europe, we have many guideposts and waymarks left by Dan. The city Dunkirk, meaning Church of Dan, Dundee, Dunbar, Dunraven, Edinburgh, and even London. If anything, this demonstrates that the tribe of Dan were continuously migrating into Europe. So did the tribe of Dan ever claim a country for themselves? Is there any land in the world named after Dan? Denmark, the name of the modern country in Europe, north of Germany, literally means Dan's mark, Dan's land, Dan's last resting place. Its people are called the Danes. According to their legends, they originated from a patriarch called Dan. The first king allegedly to rule over Denmark was also called Dan, as well as many later kings were also named Dan. In addition, because at one time Denmark ruled all the surrounding regions, the whole region took its name from them, the Scandinavian Peninsula. Clearly, here are the remnants of the people of Dan who migrated westward overland from the Caucasus to the present location in Northern Europe. The ships constructed by the Norse were long and slender. They were very low down. The shallow draft of the Norse warships had several advantages. The Norse could raid well inland by sailing far up rivers that were normally way too shallow for typical seagoing vessels of the day. The Frankish kingdoms in present-day France were astonished by the Norse raids in unthinkable location, hundreds of kilometers inland on rivers not thought possible to be navigable. In addition, they had a serpent or dragon head placed on the front. Thus, in many ways, they sailed like snakes or serpents down the rivers and through the oceans and seas. When you consider this with the Viper's Trail prophecy of the Danes, it is startlingly accurate. The Long Serpent, or the Ormond Lung, was the most legendary warship and the pride of the Norwegian king Olaf. It was built on special orders of Tryggvason, who had captured a similar but smaller dragon ship. This one had to be far larger and more carefully put together. Snorri Sturluson wrote in Heimskringla, it was exceptionally long, built on the model Drakkar, and its stem and stern were gilded. The ship was long, broad, high-sided, and strongly timbered. The ship was a dragon. The other major prophecy is that Dan, which can mean to judge, would judge his people as one of the tribes of Israel. However, could this be a misunderstanding or perhaps a mistranslation? You see, the word Dan can also have other meanings than simply judge or to be judge. It can also mean to vindicate, to govern, to rule, to strive against, or to contend with. Now, when it comes to prophecies, quite often it's difficult, if not impossible, to tell what the prophecy is all about until centuries or even thousands of years after the prophecy has happened. Then you have the luxury of being able to look back and realize what the prophecy was all about. So would a better translation have been, Dan shall strive against his people as one of the tribes of Israel, or Dan shall contend with his people? Is there any European nation or people who at one period contended with and strove against all the other European nations, all the other tribes, collectively at one time? Did the Danes raid, plunder, and loot all the other tribes and nations of Europe by any chance? The Viking raids, which largely involved the Danes and Norse peoples, hit virtually every country in Europe. Most known famously, they invaded England, trying to completely take it over, also hitting Scotland, Wales and Ireland, so all the British Isles. They raided Brittany, Frisia and the Frankish kingdoms, sailing right up the rivers into Paris. Spain was not safe either, the Iberian states, all the coast right round, and the Italian states as well. In the east of Europe, they made extensive use of the rivers, so Germany and Poland, even reaching the Byzantine Empire, the Middle East and Persia. But they also went north, moving into Finland and conquest as far as Russia, for settlements, Iceland, Greenland, and there is evidence of America. So when we look at the entire prophecy with this information, Dan shall strive against his people. The raid certainly did cause the nations of Europe to tumble backwards and civilizations stagnated, but this also had a positive effect. It caused the nations of Europe to unify and homogenize under a Christian monarch. If they wanted to remain Christian, well, they'd have to fight for it and come together, putting all their faith in God to overcome the pagan invaders. For example, in England around 790 AD, before the Vikings arrived, it was a hodgepodge of petty kingdoms and warring states. There were as many as at least 11 different kingdoms on the main island, England, Wales and Scotland. They were continuously competing year by year, claiming territory back and forth from each other. But once the Vikings arrived, this all changed as the raids increased. They also completely overwhelmed the Anglo-Saxon populace. By 875, they controlled two-thirds of England, and their only real holdout was Alfred the Great in Wessex. And for a time, even he was hiding in the marshes. By the time of his death, however, in 899, he had turned the tide and became the dominant ruler on the island, the first known king of the Anglo-Saxons. Similar circumstances occurred all throughout Europe. Eventually, of course, the Nordic countries themselves would become Christians, but they were the very last ones. Thus, the last part of the prophecy, "I have waited for thy salvation," can only be referring to them being the last to accept Christ and Christianity. When you examine the various forms of Norse runes and compare them to the Hebrew Phoenician alphabet, you will notice how strikingly similar to each other they are. If we have an understanding that the Israelites migrated to Europe and that we are all the same people as the Old Testament, then it is certainly no surprise. We brought our alphabet and language with us. Since our ancestors were deported by the Assyrians and for a time had prolonged interactions with their society as well as the Medes and the Persians, our languages also picked up many of their words. Greek also comes from the Phoenician alphabet and then Latin from Greek. So whatever way you want to trace it, all of our languages share the same origin from the Hebrew, from our ancestors. Languages, dialects and alphabets are always continuously evolving, and with the influence of the Catholic Church, gradually all European countries homogenized their alphabets into the modern alphabet we have today. One of the common questions you'll find is, why is Dan not in the Book of Revelation? The Book of Revelation chapter 7 tells us of 12,000 from each tribe being sealed. To give a quick overview, this chapter is about the incoming destruction of Rome, and this part is where it's momentarily suspended while the tribes could be sealed. This assures us that a sufficient number of Israelites would survive the judgment to come upon the empire. And by this we know all the tribes of Israel are still alive today, they are not missing. There is no tribe of Dan mentioned here, which gives us a historical clue as to the context of this sealing. The tribe of Dan was not mentioned because the main body of the tribe as Israel existed in the world at this time, but it was not within the bounds of the empire, nor amongst those invading the empire, the Germanic tribes, but rather they were quite safe up in Northern Europe, such as Denmark and the other Nordic countries. Since Dan was for the most part up in Scandinavia, it is not mentioned by the author of the Book of Revelation for that reason, but rest assured, the tribe of Dan is still with us today. So, if the tribe of Dan went to Europe and is still here and they were white, what did the other tribes look like? Would they not all have been in Europe as well? In future videos, we shall take a look at all the other tribes, where they are, what their prophecies foretold, and what it means today. The Europeans are the same people as the Old Testament, the descendants of Jacob. When you read the Bible, you're reading your own family's book, and the time is coming when our people will finally wake up.